We also have reports from the International Monetary Fund, which has called for prudence on the part of countries around the world in managing debt burden, as global public debt to gross domestic product has risen to 100%. IMF's Managing Director, Kristalina Georgieva, in curtain raiser speech at the IMF World Bank annual meetings in Washington, stressed the need for sovereigns to be more prudent and structure their medium-term framework to reduce their debt burdens. She also notes that low-income countries, which are the faction Nigeria is also grouped into, face particular challenges with massive financing needs, high debt burdens, and most recently, sharply higher debt servicing costs. On steps taken by the fund to boost global recovery, she also says, and IMF will remain a steadfast partner of its member countries, which includes Nigeria, and will continue to calibrate its financial support as well as policy analysis and technical advice. And now, bringing into perspective this discussion, Nigeria spent about 1.4 trillion naira on debt servicing payments in the first half of this year, and that's according to latest data we have from the Debt Management Office. Now, in the first quarter of this year, Nigeria spent 1.02 trillion naira on both domestic and external debt servicing, while a total of 445.45 billion naira was spent in the second quarter of this year. A further breakdown of this report shows that from January to March, marking the first quarter of this year, Nigeria spent 612.71 billion naira on domestic debt servicing, while it spent 1 billion naira, dollars, I beg your pardon, on external debt servicing from the second quarter of this year. The country also spent 322.7 billion naira on domestic debt servicing and $299 million, an equivalent of 122.7 billion naira on external debt servicing. However, in the proposed 2022 budget that President Buhari is getting set to present in a joint session of the National Assembly tomorrow, aggregate deficit inclusive of GOEs and project-tied loans is projected to increase by at least 692 billion naira, leading to an increase of 3.42% of the GDP from 3.05% of the GDP, as the government would need to source for about 7.91 trillion naira to finance the 2022 budget deficit. Well, joining me now live in our Lagos studio to discuss this and much more, I have with me the Chief Investment Officer of AfriInvest West Africa. Good to have you on the show today, and it's been a pleasure having you on the show.
Thank you very much.
Now, let's start off with Nigeria's total public debts levels, 35.5 trillion naira as of June this year, the first half of this year. And we've seen an increase in terms of quarter-on-quarter basis. Now, in the face of dwindling reserves and revenue generation capacity, as well as devaluation facing the country's debt burden continues to spike, and this is a major cause for worry.
Yes, indeed. It's a very worrying, or I would say worrisome situation when you look at Nigeria's debt stock. And perhaps sometimes it's good for us to put things into context. When you mention 35 trillion of total public debt, let's be aware that doesn't absolutely capture total debt stock, because there is a line for funding of the federal government through budgets by the central bank. It's called ways and means.
Exactly.
As we speak today, the data on ways and means is estimated at about 15 trillion. Right, and the run rate we have adopted this year so far, by the end of this year, we should be hitting close to 17 trillion in ways and means funding of the central, of the federal government. Now, if you add that value to 35 trillion, you're talking about a total debt stock of 50 trillion and still counting. Now, when you look at the numbers and the costs of servicing that debt, looking at what you just read out in the report that suggested that we spent about 1.4 trillion to service the debt in only 6 months of the year. I mean, at that run rate, it means that we're servicing our debt at close to about 2.8 trillion, you know, by the end of the year. And but don't forget that that has not captured ways and means. So if it captures ways and means, indeed, we would have been
spending
close to 5 trillion, you know, at the best case, maybe 4.5 trillion in servicing our debt. As we speak today, full year 2020 revenue suggested that federal government revenue was 3.9. The retained revenue for central federal government was 3.9 trillion. Now, at the run rate we are going this year, perhaps we are lucky to hit about 4.5 or maybe best case 5 trillion. Now, this suggests that in the real sense of it, all of the revenues we make, we're using them to service our debt. Not repay.
Service our debt.
Service.
Yes.
Because the cost of, you know, those debts, you know, look at Ways and Means, for example, that central bank advances to the government. Is that MPR plus, I think, 200 or 300 basis points. That's above, you know, 12% levels. The average debt in the local market, you know, outside of treasury bills, is in the double digits, right? So in the international market, we also have debts that are below, you know, double digits, but because of exchange rate factors, they also impact on. So we're talking about servicing our debt with close to, like, if you put all the numbers together, close to about 4.5 trillion or, you know, 4 trillion if we want to be conservative. But that's absolutely all the revenues that we earn. Should we continue this way? Definitely not. If you look at our expenditure pattern, right, I think it was in 2012, that's about 9 years ago, that we recorded a total expenditure profile of about 4.8 trillion. But today we are talking about 14.8 trillion in 9 years, right? That is about the revenue, you know, if you look at 2012 expenditure profile, it's about the revenue we are now making in 2021. What business do we have spending 14.8 trillion when our revenue is barely 5 trillion?
Now, that brings me to the question of Nigeria looking at restructuring or addressing the debt portfolio. And like you made mention of, we now have to begin to start looking at non-interest pay, paying commercial bonds and other alternatives, because you see other countries adopt such initiatives, but Nigeria just has this fixation on taking such debts that you can't pay the interest well over.
You see, I think our issues go beyond the structuring of the debts we want to take.
At least in the short term.
I think our concept of debt in its entirety, it's wrong. I mean, just think about a household that earns 5 trillion naira in revenue. And that 5 trillion is barely, we have even barely made that 5 trillion in revenue. And then you build in expenditure profile of almost 15 trillion. Year in, year out. I mean, you know that if you are an individual, if not that the government has the capacity to continue to print money, by now you should have been bankrupted as an individual or a corporate, because you can't fund those expenditure, you know, profile. Now we continue to do this because we are able to turn to the central bank to get money and then we fund it. But you look at the inflationary implication of what we are doing and the impact it will have on the overall well-being of the economy. And that's why we need to take caution. So there is a discussion about, okay, let's look for, you know, efficient ways of borrowing money, right? Which is what you're saying makes a lot of sense. But there is the point that should we even have a budget close to 14 trillion? Definitely not. Because the capacity of government cannot support that kind of budgeting. I mean, how do we... I mean, we know fiscal deficit is what countries adopt the world over. But where you have a situation where our revenue is about a third of our spending, of course, you know that our capital spending is not two-thirds of our spending.
Yes.
If it's not two-thirds of our spending, definitely we are borrowing to fund recurrent expenditure. That is, we are borrowing to pay salaries, we are borrowing to, you know,
on consumptions largely.
Consumption, which is the wrong thing to do. So if we want to have this conversation, what we should be talking about now is fiscal consolidation. Fiscal consolidation is when you deliberately want to reduce the size of government, you know, by cutting the size of government expenditure. I think there is a wrong belief in government that government needs to spend so much, you know, for us to achieve.
But why is it difficult for the government to take such aggressive measures? We've seen streamlining of budgets just looking at the overhead cost of government. Why is it difficult here in Nigeria? Certain allowances, certain expenditures, certain allocations make no economic sense. Why is this a blind spot, really?
It's not a blind spot.
So we know what we're doing.
Of course. It's just unfortunate that the way the Nigerian project is run many of our politicians will not run their businesses that way. I mean, politicians own businesses and they behave rationally when it comes to their business. But when it comes to the government projects,
I understand what you say, that the numbers don't lie. They have a clear sense of what's going on.
I don't want to believe that people in government do not have understanding of these things.
But well, if you know better, you do better. Robert, wouldn't you say?
We need the political will to get a lot of these things done. I don't want to delve into the politics of things, but, you know, because this is not a political show, and I'm not a political analyst either, you know. But the issues we're trying to trash out here is our activities today, they have consequences on, you know, the generations yet unborn. I mean, you look at the numbers, and it's staggering. It's worrying, you know. We're not talking about exchange rate now because that's a different policy,
ball game.
A ball game in itself. But it has impact on what is also going on, right? Perhaps government is thinking about its budget in terms in dollar terms. So government may argue that in 2012, when we spent 4.8 trillion naira expenditure, perhaps in dollar terms that was far higher. Of course, it's higher than what 14.8 trillion. Naira amounts to today. So in dollar terms, we are spending less. But in naira terms, look at the budget size. It's bloated. And the revenue fundamentals do not support the kind of spending we're doing today.
Okay.
We need to take a break. I think that's the caution. I mean, it's too late. There is 2022 budget, which the president is about to present. I don't think that budget will factor in the reality. In the real sense of it. And what is the reality? Government's total revenue, you know, and you could go back in time since 2012 till date, government revenue has increased on a yearly basis. But the total we have as of today, estimate for this year is about 4.8 trillion.
So what do you think are going to be some of the biggest mistakes you're going to have in terms of the presentation of this budget to the Joint National Assembly? We are counting down till tomorrow. Latest by noon, we expect to have this presentation done. Now, we're looking at the fact that the reality lies that in the last 5 years, we've seen no less than 20%, as of now, speaking of our debt-to-GDP ratio. That's also another call that government needs to see that these figures are not just in safe thresholds anymore.
Not anymore. You see, again, I get scared for the country as an economist when I think about, you know, the way we go. And, I mean, if I were called to be the president of this country in 2023, I wouldn't answer.
Run for safety.
Honestly, because I don't even know where we want to start in terms of, you know, the economy. How do we start thinking
about... Do you say
there
is no respite?
Well, there is, but do we have the will? That's the thing. Because this calls for fiscal discipline, you know, which is most times very difficult. And when you talk about fiscal discipline, can we afford to cut the size of budget by at least 50%? That's where to start. We have to cut it by at least 50%. And that is when our revenues can match, you know, the sort of budgets that we are putting out there. Definitely, we have been going through, sourcing this, funding this budget by debt. But we can't continue that path because, as you can see, as we speak today, government revenue is not enough to pay the cost of servicing our debt.
Talk less of keep the nation afloat.
Thank you. Now, so that's where the problem is. And this is where we need to be a bit more disciplined.
Now, how deficient would you also say this mark of the first half of this year? We are only seeing about 63% of the budget revenue target being met. Now, this is a highly deficient budget, and you are just meeting a little bit above 10% the average. So that necessarily means that a budget which you expected should have about 100%, if it was okay, is now at a shortfall level, much more than that. So when we are looking at government also taking on certain responsibilities, like the subsidy regime that we have on ground now, we are seeing oil price rally, and in the international community, the next body language is that Nigeria is earning a little bit much more. The benchmark we have should be sort of cushion for us in terms of our external reserves. The fluctuations there is on one hand, but the spending too does not necessarily make sense. We're waiting for a feasible framework to be developed before we can remove the subsidy regime. How long will it take for the government to understand all of these? And what do you also expect from the National Assembly tomorrow in knocking this breakdown properly, so that at least if we're going to have amendments or changes or adjustments, it's something that would start leading to the right area? We are expecting about 100 billion naira extra. That's part of the additions for 2022 because the election year is coming. So this is a very tough terrain. We have to be critical. The CBN governor has also said that we've largely used up almost all our arsenals there in terms of monetary expectations or approaches. So what else can the fiscal authorities do?
You know, if you model the spending on subsidy and you try to find the impact,
over 900 billion naira, as
you try to find impact on growth, right? I mean, it's believed that when government spends, it should be towards an ultimate objective. And I want to believe that one of the reasons why government is paying subsidies is to so-called help the poor, as we say. But the impact on growth is negative, you know. And we shouted this for decades. So I don't know why we can't just see reasons. Look at the numbers. They don't make sense. Yet, we want to continue to pay subsidy. I don't know why we should wait for any time, you know, further before we take that critical decision about, you know, taking out certain leakages, such as the payment of subsidy, right? Without going into that argument as to who does subsidy benefit, you know, we've said it over and over, and I can prove it. It doesn't benefit the poor, not in any way. Unfortunately, most people don't understand, you know, how these things work, you know, because if you think about it, Nigeria is still the poverty capital of the world. Most people live on, you know, $1.20 per day, at least majority of Nigerians. You know, that's barely 1,000 naira. So how much do those spend on buying fuel in their generators, you know, and are they engaging in activities that allow them to take public transport? Because most of them live in the rural areas. So it actually makes sense if we take out subsidy and spend on what is directly impactful on the poor.
Some would rather say not health or education.
Yes, of course. Look at our educational standard. It's deteriorating. Now, let's ask a sincere question. How many people in government can put their kids in public school? And let's be sincere. We know what is going on, you know. So that's a critical sector of the economy that we need to spend on. Now, we're talking about governance and how deficient we are.
But government, in its response,
if you don't
to tell
your human capital, how will they be useful for you 10 years, 20 years, 30 years down the
government
line?
Government now, in its defense,
the best of our brains are leaving the country, right? So what that means is that, you know, election cycles come, and the rest, you know, whether they have sufficient education or not, they will be in government,
but
and they will
see,
make policies for the country.
As part of some of the capital projects that have been undertaken, you say infrastructure development. Would you say some of the debt we've taken so far has aggressively been tilted towards infrastructure development, from power to roads to road networks and other infrastructural development that would also help incentivize the business climate, help attract more investors, more budgetary allocation or funding towards fighting insecurity and much more? These are areas where if you have to take any sort of borrowing on, those are the areas you ought to deal with. Do you think in your scorecard now, how would you rate all of our borrowings to have things that we can really count and say under the Buhari administration or any other administration, we've been able to achieve X, Y, Z?
Honestly, the government is trying so hard to fix infrastructure. I mean, as you may be aware, you know, apart from the budgetary allocation to funding road network and the likes, you know, there are other efforts that's been made. You know, Central Bank just in consortium with AFC, you know, and NSIA, just trying to float an infrastructure fund, all geared towards all geared towards, you know, improving the stock of infrastructure in the country. But the issue now is that those are efforts that are very critical and needed to get us to where we want to be, you know. But I dare say that the revenue structure of the country. And I'm emphasizing on the revenue structure. And if you speak with people in government, they will tell you, well, our debt to GDP is tolerable. Mm. And honestly, it's tolerable. But how do we now, so when we take the debt, how do we pay back when our revenues are going to only servicing those debts? And that's where the issue
Robert,
is.
Robert, let me share with you this paragraph. Now, the global wave of asset-linked securitization increasing converts dead, idle, and underutilized public corporate infrastructure, fiscal and intangible assets into new sources of immediate fiscal liquidity and future revenue flows required to close the infrastructure gaps and unlock latent growth potential. Do you see any sense in this statement, and why is it difficult for the government to also understand such a statement?
You know, again,
this is a clear statement.
You know, again, when you're on TV like this, you also have to be circumspect. Mm. You know, and you know, there are issues that are fundamental to us, which I do not believe that.
Now, this is looking at assets that we could actually liquidate, you know, or have revenues come from idle.
Now, that's what I'm saying, that there are issues that are fundamental to us that government clearly, you know, is aware that there are certain low-hanging fruits that can be tapped into. Now, the point is, do we have the political will? Because, you know, the sentiment on the street is also that once you put up asset for sale, you're selling, you know, the posterity of the country. You know, there are different school of thought. You know, even Nigerians, is it easy to govern, you know, the crop of Nigerians that we have? You know, those are some of the issues that then come into play. Mm. But by and large, I believe that the government should have the will and the courage to do what is right in the best interests of the country. There are times that you will take, you know, decisions that the populace will not like, such as subsidy. Mm. But it takes boldness and courage of people in government to say, okay, we do not care. Even if you don't re-elect us, we will do what we think is right for the country. But that's what I think is lacking. Maybe we don't have sufficient courage. We are still afraid that elections are coming. We want people to vote for us, you know.
Robert, we have perhaps less than 2 minutes. We have less than 2 minutes to wrap up this conversation. I would like your thoughts on also dealing with developing a much more robust budget implementation index, or our debt index, to put things in perspective. You've made mention of the fact that the ratio of capital and recurrent expenditure makes no economic sense. That balance has been the prototype we followed all throughout these years. But when you have reports like that of budgets, which is highlighted that, take for example, from last year to this year, we've had well over 300 capital projects replicated in this year's budget, which is also accounted for out of revenue that is expected to be generated this year. How does such information just filter and get swept under the carpet? And we might likely see such reports again replicate come 2022.
Now,
do you think this sort of thing interferes?
So let's put things in perspective. Now, budgeting, it's you know, an affair that suggests your intention to spend. So if you plan to spend on project ABC in 2020,
you must repeat that in 2021.
You know, 2020, I mean, plan to spend doesn't mean that you have the revenue to support that spending, you know. So if your total expenditure profile in 2020, say, was 12 trillion or 13 trillion, but at the end of the year, you were only able to spend 10 trillion. That 10 trillion could have been allocated to what is most critical.
I ask so this what because means, of nipping corruption.
No, I understand. So what that then means is that if there is a project ABC that was in 2020 budget that wasn't funded,
exactly,
it's only natural that the project, if it's a critical project that the government believes in, it's only natural that that project will surface again in 2021.
Under the premise that no allocation was provided.
Of course, under the premise that no allocation was provided. So I don't think government will put in a budget for which there was a funding towards it and then replicate the same project in 2021. And if there is, I'm not privy to that. But I believe that if there is a project that was, you know, that featured in 2020, and it's now showing in 2021, it only means that it wasn't funded. Because the fact that it's in the budget does not mean that, you know, it's going to get funding. Mm. So if at the end of the fiscal year it wasn't funded, it's natural that you bring it back in the next.
And how do we develop a robust implementation and corruption index for our budget and borrowing?
You see, on corruption, it's bigger than this conversation. It's a lot, you know, to put in there if you are going to, you know, mirror what is actually going on, because it's endemic, you know, it's endemic to us. It's all over the place on our system. So, I mean, I don't know, whoever is developing that index, we have a tough job to do, as a matter of fact, if you do succeed.
Well, that's one of the ways we can also slim our budget size, slim also our recurrent expenditure, and also reduce the cost of governance.
Yeah.
We've seen the world at large, we've seen certain models be adopted, and it's not just simplistic as it
looks. Absolutely. So what I call the cost of governance is what goes into recurrent expenditure. We need to slash it by not less than 50%. And that's when we are taking more seriously.
Thank you very much for your time on the show today, Robert Omotunde. We've been speaking with the Chief Investment Officer of AfriInvest West Africa. Thank you very much. And then we'll keep our fingers crossed to see what sort of presentation we'll have tomorrow, as the President also presents the 2022 budget. And hopefully by the end of this year, we'll also have an assessment of the performance of this year's budget and see to what extent we've had any change at all. Thank you very much.
Thank you.